Matthew Bellacchio, President of the Music Hall Board of Trustees. This year, we're celebrating our 75th anniversary as a nonprofit educational and cultural center and our 75th summer recital series. This is the fourth program in our 15-week series, and it is sponsored by Campbell Stewart. We'd like to thank Mr. Stewart and all our sponsors whose generous support is making this year's recital series possible. And we invite you, our viewers, to visit our website, mmmh.org, and look for the donate link to help support the music hall. Thank you. Tonight's performer, Adam Pajan, teaches organ at the University of Oklahoma and is director of music at St. Mark the Evangelist Catholic Church in Norman, Oklahoma, and artist in residence at St. John's Episcopal Church in Tulsa. Dr. Pajan won first prize in three prestigious American organ competitions and has played at many national organ conventions. Here's an interesting bit of trivia. The famous American poet, Robert Frost, grew up just south of here in Lawrence, Massachusetts, and briefly was a grammar school teacher here in Methuen. One of his best-loved poems, The Road Not Taken, describes a dilemma of choosing between the more traveled and the less traveled road. Many of our recitalists take the more traveled road and play major works by famous composers. But tonight, Adam is taking the less traveled road. His program features engaging works by lesser-known composers and will include his own transcription of three George Gershwin piano preludes. He will tell us about his pieces. Robert Frost's poem, The Road Not Taken, concludes with the following lines. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. We hope you enjoy this program.
Thank you. Good evening. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here to present the program this evening as part of the 75th anniversary series here at Methuen Memorial Music Hall, and to have spent a couple of days with this utterly magnificent instrument. We've just heard the Marche Triumphale by Walter Alcock, which I kind of describe as the organ's big brother version of Pomp and Circumstance. I think it's got wonderful Victorian flair, and we'll hear a little bit more of that later in the program. Next offering is the first sonata of Paul Hindemith. Hindemith born in Hanau, Germany, not far outside of Frankfurt, and then eventually immigrating to the United States and teaching at my alma mater, Yale University. Wrote three organ sonatas, and Hindemith's harmonic language is somewhat post-tonal, but still has tonal centers in it. So we normally find that there's a certain amount of consonants at the beginning and end of a phrase, but with some amount of harmonic divergence in the center. The first sonata is what I would kind of describe as being gray almost in tone. So in this particular piece, I'm trying to seek out some of the slightly more slender chorus sounds, so especially some of the ones that were incorporated by Aeolian-Skinner in 1947. So here's the Hindemith first sonata.
Thank you.
The final work on the first half of the program is by British composer turned Canadian, Healey Willan, of course known for producing a huge body of really excellent choral and Anglican church music. Amongst, of course, his most famous organ works is the massive Introduction, Passacaglia, and Fugue, though that's not the one for tonight, don't worry, it's not all 17 minutes of it. Instead, this is a work written in 1965, and Willan dying in 68, so it's very late in his output, in Andante, Fugue, and Chorale. It's much more succinct in its form, but still shows Willan to be very much of a romantic at heart, especially through his expansive lines and really luscious harmony.
My name is Jonathan Ambrosino. I'm a Boston-based organ technician. My colleague Joe Sloan and I are privileged to care for some of the Boston area's other notable pipe organs, those at Trinity Copley Square, Old South, and many others. And in addition, I'm active as a writer and tonal finisher nationally and a consultant to projects involving both old and new organs. But as a Boston native, I have many childhood memories of this place. I grew up in the Men and Boys Choir at St. Paul's Cathedral in downtown Boston. And that choir held its annual summer camps at Governor Dummer Academy, which is quite near to here. And not surprisingly, this amazing place was a logical field trip destination. And we would occasionally be involved in concerts with our conductor, the eminent organist Thomas Murray. Mr. Murray, as we called him, made it a practice that anyone who hadn't ever been here should be introduced to it properly. Hands over their eyes, the uninitiated would be led in until positioned just centrally, directly in front of the case. And only then could you open your eyes and take in the overwhelming spectacle of this case and this amazing hall. Later in my teen years, and now over the decades, I've attended countless recitals here, sometimes turning pages on that strong, long bench that actually has room for a page turner to sit comfortably. And in that role, I'm like a lot of organ groupies in these parts, attending events year after year. Methuen is baked into the local organ culture. And one of the glories of the annual summer series here is that it showcases and supports such a range of talent, rising stars, local personalities, eminent people from faraway places like Nebraska and Omaha and Oklahoma, the familiar and the unfamiliar, and those very active on the national stage. The hall is now running its second annual summer series entirely online. And while these surroundings may be opulent, don't be fooled. This isn't some rich old New England institution bathed in endowment. It is and always has been a small nonprofit organization, staffed and run by an all-volunteer board. Here is the very definition of labor of love. This year, as last, there are no in-person audiences, and that means no ticket sales. And thus, this great building and tremendous organ certainly don't look after themselves. It is only through ticket sales, hall rentals, and the thoughtful donations of people who care about this place that it survives. And we don't want it merely to survive. It should flourish. Last year, my household gave generously, and this year we'll do it again, even more so. This series enriches our lives. It helps those who want to make a career of organ playing. And now with these online concerts, it's spreading music farther and wider than ever. So, donate as so many of us have. You can reach the website at mmmh.org, and making an online donation is easy. Thank you so much for watching, and please enjoy the second half.
We'll begin the second half of the program, as Matthew indicated in the introduction, with my own transcription of the three Gershwin piano preludes. You might not initially think that Gershwin is a harmonic or rhythmic idiom that translates particularly well to the organ, but hope to convince you otherwise. I particularly enjoy playing these pieces because I think there's something of a surprise, and as I said, a harmonic idiom that we don't often find at the organ. Here are the three Gershwin piano preludes.
Thank you.
As I tell my students, there are some pieces in the repertoire that have not become part of the traditional canon, and probably for a good reason. There are others, however, that have not become part of the canon, but still have quite a bit of merit. And I have found this to be true of the couple of works that I have learned from Basil Harwood, obviously a British composer, and was instrumental in founding the Oxford Bach Choir. So here we have In an Old Abbey. It's also imbued with this wonderful sense of Victorian grandeur. As I was preparing it and a friend heard, he said, it sounds to me like it's a procession. And it makes quite a bit of sense. Perhaps the brothers are first outside meandering around a bit and listening to the birds after a brief introduction. And then we get this wonderful sense of building and of crescendo until the introductory material returns for a beautifully repose ending. Thank you so much for joining this evening. I would highly encourage you to support the series here and to tune in to the remainder of the series and listen to the rest of my colleagues as they help round out this very exciting 75th anniversary season. I also want to offer a few brief words of thanks to my very gracious host for this week, Matthew Balacchio, who has been really wonderful in helping me get everything set with my practice times and hosting me. Thank you, Matthew. Likewise, to Fred MacArthur, who has been here through the week and gave me a tour through the inside of the instrument, helped me to understand better the Valker and Aeolian-Skinner components, and has just been a wonderful help. So thank you. And as well to Kevin Neal for turning pages. I hate turning pages. I think it's the most terrifying job in the room. So thanks for your help, Kevin. So I hope that you've enjoyed some of this less traveled road, which will now take us to Austria, the work of Franz Schmidt. When I first programmed this work 3 years ago for a recital in Trier, my colleague Martin Bombauer said, about 10 years, once every 10 years, somebody is daring enough to program a work by Franz Schmidt. And daring might be interchanged with many other words. But this toccata, while very extroverted and exciting and bubbly, is also ferociously difficult. But I think that it makes quite a great impact on this instrument. And you'll be able to hear at the first major point of chorus a stop that draws many of the original chorus ranks from the Valker. So you'll get to hear it as close as possible. And if I may add a quick personal note, it's really special for me to be able to present this program as my first public performance in Germany was on this organ's sister instrument in the Marchkirche in Wiesbaden. So it's a particular joy to be able to kind of come full circle. So here is the toccata of Franz Schmidt.